It's been a while. It's been a while since we've been at a live music event. Let's hear it. We are in the beautiful, beautiful museum here in downtown London. Thank you all for coming. I will be your host tonight. I am Corey Crossman, your London Music Development Officer. It is a pleasure to be here. So it has been a long time since people have been at a live music event. When is this anyone's first time back at a live music event? Okay, we got a good group of people that have been out and been back. That's very cool. Well, we're going to have some fun tonight. First off, I want to thank our hosts here at Museum London and Words Fest for having us. Round of applause. Josh and the team at Words Fest, it's fantastic to be back here. A couple small sort of housekeeping items. You all filled out a ballot on the way in here. We got some prizing for you at the end of the night that I will address and talk about. So best of luck to everyone on that. We've got a great list of artists here, and why we're here is to talk about music and the words and the meaning behind those songs. We're also looking at curators in the community that are driving change and doing really cool, unique things in our community. So we have an awesome talent pool here, and I want everybody to give a round of applause to everybody that you'll see on the stage today. A special shout out to ShowPro for all the work that they're doing here today. Chuck and the technical team. We wouldn't be here, and you wouldn't be hearing me without that technical team, or you wouldn't be watching online. So welcome online. I'd also like to thank Julie Bevan and say hello. We haven't met in person yet, but hey. welcome. Welcome to London, and I'm very thankful that we have an opportunity like this. I'm going to read a land acknowledgement. I think this is an important piece as we move forward. So in the spirit of truth and reconciliation, we would like to acknowledge that Museum London operates within the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, Attawandaran, Neutral, and Wendat peoples. This territory is covered by the Upper Thames Treaties. This territory is the homeland of the Chippewas of the Thames First Nation, Oneida Nation of the Thames, Munsee Delaware Nation. We also like to recognize the contributions of Métis, Inuit, and other Indigenous peoples, both in shaping and strengthening this community, in particular in this community, across the province, as well as the country as a whole. So thank you. All right, let's get our curators up here. I think this is an important part now. Let's welcome all of them up. Please come on up to the stage. We labeled the microphones too, so we know the order. So Richard, number one. There we go. All right. We are going to get underway. This project, we're doing sort of a soft launch of a project called All Roads Lead Downtown. You can have a seat. Sit down. Yeah, stay a while. Yeah, stay a while. This is going to be fun. This was, you know, a project that was supposed to launch last October. We've had some challenges along the way, but we are back and we are seeing some live music. And the idea was we went up to community members that are doing really unique, cool things in the community, and we asked them to develop a playlist and talk about, you know, why London's great, why London's a great music community, and highlight some of the incredible artists that call London home. So we have our four curators here. First one, Richard Gracious. The second one, Pablo Tavar. Our third curator, Zara Habib. And our fourth curator, Sarah Mae Chitty. So you'll be hearing from them tonight. I'm going to ask three of them to leave the stage, and we're going to keep Richard up here, keep him under the spotlight. So if the three of you could grab your seats, thank you. They're going to hear some good stories from them tonight. All right. Good hustle. Good work. Yeah. So first up, we got Richard Gracious. Tell us a little bit about you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Richard Gracious, local musician, a producer, and yeah, I like to make music in London. That's about it.
You do it all, eh? You do it all. Cool. So what is your favorite thing about London's music scene? Do you have something that just stands out that you really like?
I think everyone can agree that London's music scene is pretty unique, where you can go out and you can see all your friends, but no matter what scene you go to, whether it be like a punk show or a bigger show at music hall or smaller shows at breweries, there's a lot of people that are open to different genres, so it's not a very genre-specific scene. And what I really like, people being fluid through that, and I consider myself one of those where we just go out to see good music regardless of genre, and London really helps promote that, I think. Makes it easier to create.
And I think that's one of the reasons why we've become a UNESCO City of Music. And is everyone familiar with that? Have we heard about that? Awesome. All right. So we are the first city in Canada with the designation as a UNESCO City of Music. And I think it really does pay tribute to the decades and years of great music in this community and the amazing work people have been doing, right? So you get to stand. Okay,
I'm just going to stand.
Yeah, go for it. Yeah. but yeah, I think it's a deep-rooted community with a lot of really unique things taking place. So the artists that you picked, tell us a little bit about who's on your playlist.
So my playlist, I really focused on artists I had seen perform live in London. And so like Heart Attack Kids, Jared from Heart Attack Kids, everyone's been to Call the Office. And if you haven't, I'm sorry if you didn't get that opportunity. But that's a London memory that we can all hold dear. But I remember seeing them there a long time ago. And then seeing the Pairs play around town. We got Noelle. And she's one quarter of the Pairs. Is that how you guys do it? I guess so. Yeah. And then Ben Heffernan, he's a younger kid coming up in the scene, and I've seen him play at breweries and stuff. And then I think I have like July Talk on there, and I saw them at Music Hall. And then Status, Non-Status, and I've like originally seen them evolve from like what was Whoopso previously, and seeing them play in like record shops and on Record Store Day, and seeing just all these acts mature really made me be like, yeah, this is what London's about. The people that are staying and creating a scene and playing at our local venues and making them what they are.
Okay, cool. Well, I think you've heard enough from me. So why don't we welcome some of your artists up?
Yeah, let's Noelle, get Noelle.
Jared. Let's get them both up here at the same time.
Oh, Noelle yeah, and Jared, both of you up here. Come on down. I'm going to interview both of them. We're going to take turns. You're both going to come up. You're going to play a tune. We'll talk. Then we'll talk to the other one. Jared, you're coming up. You're up now. Yeah, you got to come up. That's what Corey said. Give it up for Jared and Noelle again. We'll give them a second here to go. While they're taking their time, do we have any questions out there? Anything about the local scene, UNESCO, about Noelle and Jared? Now's your chance. You missed your chance. So, Noelle. So we have Noelle and Jared for you, and Noelle plays in a band called The Pairs, and she also has her solo project. And so we'll probably be hearing, I don't know what she's going to play for you, and I don't think she's going to tell you until she's ready to do it. So she's still deciding, and you know what, I feel that as a musician, because sometimes you want to like read the room, and so you guys are getting a pretty unique experience that's curated just for you. There's no predetermined set list, there's no generic tour show. This is pretty intimate. And Jared, what do you got planned? I'm getting some new songs from Jared. Yeah. So there we go. Woo! Yep. So do you want to play the song first, or do you want to talk about it stuff first? Your choice. Let's play, and then we'll hear you play, and then we'll talk about. So everyone, give it up for Noelle. I'm gonna.
I am a big fan of how much clapping has already happened this evening. I think it's fantastic. My name's Noelle. I'm really, really grateful to be in this space with all of you tonight. So thank you. This song's called Wide and Winding. Judgment, your ethics code, each one line with a self-righteous tone. singing.
Right on. Give it up for Noel. Wow. So, question to you. Do you want to talk about the song or your songwriting?
That's the first question.
Yeah.
You asked me.
Okay, we're going to go like, that was a beautiful song, but I want to know what inspires you to write.
I think it's a very interesting question. What inspires me to write? Life, my own life experience, and stories of others that I hear, but again, that's through my own lens of how I hear the story, how I witness the world. I think songwriting for me is definitely therapeutic, and I work through a lot of shit through songwriting and singing.
With that in mind, when you're writing, do you write with the audience in mind, or are you purely just writing as a form of to get it out? Or do you do a little mix of both?
I think a little mix of both, because what I've found is I've actually found myself in periods of time where maybe the writing is more self-centered, but those songs, feedback from those songs has been positive, that it's there's other people can see themselves in that experience, which is really interesting. And then when I have tried to write with the audience in mind, I find that my ego really can get in the way of what's being created. And it actually, I feel for me, like it blocks the fluidity of creativity, because I don't feel like
you're
songs are mine. Like it's
creating.
Like,
yeah.
There's something that you're being open to, I believe.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay, Corey, are they playing two songs or one song each? Two each? Okay, so give it up for Noelle. She'll be right back. Thank you so much. So next we have Jared, and I want you guys to take a second and know that Jared plays in a punk rock and roll band. And having played in punk bands before, this is probably the worst situation to put a musician who plays punk rocks, like, hey, will you just bring your guitar and play tunes for people? So I know how hard this is and out of your comfort zone, because like when you play in a band, you're used to a certain energy, you're used to a certain volume, you're used to a certain way you can act and things. But we're PG-13 here, right, Corey? So but yeah, so give it up for Jared for getting out of his comfort zone. And I'm stoked to hear what he's got, but I have vivid memories of seeing Jared at Call the Office. And if any of you have been to Call the Office, it is probably the exact opposite of this venue. Are there working bathrooms here? Yeah. Right on. Jared, what are you going to play for? Or are you just going to, you know what, just surprise. We're all just going to sit back, let him do his thing. But I did ask him, I was like, Jared, whose guitar are you playing? Because me and Jared, we both like guitars a lot, and we both post about our guitars on social media. And like in the back of my mind, I kind of had a suspicion. He's like, yeah, I had to borrow this from your stepdad. Right on. Because he doesn't own an acoustic guitar. Not even playing his own guitars. You're just brave man. Take it away.
It's the way it goes sometimes, I guess, eh? All right. So it's called Rolling with the Punches. Down black and blue, you're down, you're out. Nothing better to do, not easy come, not easy go. You're holding on to your golden glow, you're gonna have to learn. Let that shit go. You gotta roll with the punches, you can't control everything. Just roll with the punches, you gotta take your swing. all a process to work through. Can you see what this growing to would have been right next to you? But you changed what was out of tune. You took too long, didn't follow through.
Give it up for Jared.
Thank you.
Heck yeah. First question, when's the acoustic record dropping?
Right now.
Nice. So, as a guy who plays riffs and rock and roll with distortion and effects, and what comes first, the riff or the lyrics?
I don't know. It kind of depends on the song. Lately, it's been the riff first and then the lyrics after, which is, you know, when you're stuck in your house for 3 years or whatever, sometimes you just want to play guitar.
There's a lot of riffs.
There's a lot of riffs. You can go through them if you want, and then you just end up writing over top of them, and maybe you're feeling something that day, and then the magic happens. That's it.
So how do you figure out if a riff's, like, does the riff dictate the style of the song or, like, the emotional content behind it, or do you kind of bend them to what lyrics you're feeling at the time?
No, I don't really try to bend anything into what it's, like, not supposed to be. I think when you're writing something, like, even if you're writing something on the guitar, you're feeling it in that moment, and you just take that energy with the energy that you're going to put into it.
So it's also interesting, I think, for me and Noel being up here, because we're very much acoustic, more oriented people, and not writing with an acoustic guitar. Can you imagine that? So, you always write on electric, Jared?
For the most part, or like unplugged, which is almost like an acoustic guitar, I guess.
Yeah, so do you play unplugged when you're writing, or do you like to feel the energy of the amps when you're writing? How does it go?
Well, I live in an apartment, so.
So yeah, tell us more about those limitations of trying to create when you're being confined. So that constriction creates friction, and it makes it hard, right?
It definitely does. Like, my band is very loud. And I like the feeling of, like, feeling the air behind me pushing. And that's when I feel like I know I'm doing a good job.
So how do you write when you don't have that feeling?
I think you just have to get really into it.
You
just have to pretend, yeah. And sometimes it looks a little silly, but I don't know, some of my best songs have come out that way.
That's awesome.
So, yeah. Bedroom rocker.
So, yeah. So we need more spaces for people to play loud amps in London, right?
Yes, please.
Right, Corey?
Let's go.
UNESCO, loud amps, London, and please.
Yep.
Give it up for Jared.
Thanks, guys.
I think you're back up, Noel.
Just play, Richard?
Yeah.
All right.
Is that
better? No. I like lower. I like to get a good hunch when I'm singing. Yeah, this is good. Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Here we go. What inspired me was your upbeat tunes. No more sad songs, Noelle. Just kidding, there'll always be sad songs. I heard this wonderful quote, and I can't quote the person who I heard it from properly because I don't remember it, unfortunately, but they said, music is intended to disturb the comfortable and comfort the disturbed, and I really liked that. So I hope you're all... this meets you where you need to be. I wanted to make sure it's in the right key. Okay, here we go. It's called Say When. Dropped out of your body by your head. Keep it simple as advice I used to give, but it doesn't seem to be the way they live. Now we all live a little conflicted, and we're calling.
No need for apologies. So, you mentioned sad songs. Was that a sad song?
Well, actually, I think, Richard, you helped me to do this. You and a few other people. You might not know that you helped me to do this. But it was brought to my attention that actually a lot of really upbeat, wonderful songs that we all dance to are absolutely heartbreaking. So,
yes.
To think about...
juxtaposition.
Yeah.
When it sounds happy, but the more you listen,
yeah,
it's not. So yeah. What was that song about?
That song, it's called Say When, and I wrote it just thinking about how it's easy to enter a space. I should clarify for my context as a white person, growing up in London, Ontario, entering a space, it is the comfortable position sometimes to not speak up when we hear comments that are not okay. And that song, Say When, is... I wrote it thinking about, like, we gotta change that when we feel it. As I'm talking to white people, when we feel uncomfortable in a space hearing something,
that's like a fraction of what folks who are commonly marginalized are feeling when those comments are made. So to be able to, this is a whole big topic.
No, it's good. This is what we're here for. Yeah, we're here for the big topics. Thank you.
But it's just like, it's about, you have to speak through the discomfort. You have to speak through our trembling voices and the fear of doing it wrong. And say when, like, and if we don't know exactly what to say, then we just start there, I think. We say, like, we just make people we're talking at dinner accountable to their words. Like, you have to mirror back to somebody what they just said and know that, like, you're not okay hearing it and it's not okay being said. And then what comes next is, like, probably education.
Education, discussion. It starts with a discussion, right? So with that song in mind, do you consciously pair the heavy impact of the lyrical content with the upbeat to kind of soften the blow? Or is that just something that just happens unconsciously? Or is it a choice?
I think softening a blow is never the choice. But I also think that, and I could be wrong here, and I'm completely willing to be called out if I'm wrong. I'm wrong a lot, but I think like a lot of it too is just, I forget what I was going to say because I started talking about being wrong. Anyway, seriously, I forget.
You can finish your thought if you want.
If it comes back.
If it comes back during Jared's song.
No, Jared!
Okay, give it up for Noel. Thank you. I think we do got truck on. Jared, you're back on it, Jared. Do you want to talk first? Because you're the performer, you get to choose. I'm just here to facilitate. Or you can talk first. If you're feeling like you want something, you want to say something. He's going to play first, folks.
Practice all these songs sitting down, so this is getting kind of weird. So it's called No No.
Taking the steam right out of me, digging in deep, letting all wounds bleed. These sticks, these stones, still breaking down. All we ever know, no, no, I don't listen. No, no, I can't help it. No, no, we don't pull away. Driving me crazy. Just as getting tired, it's hard to breathe. In your words, takes years out of me. I can't, you know, see your future where this house is a home. No, no, you don't listen. No, no, I can't help this. No, no. We don't pull our way. It's driving me crazy. No, no, it don't listen. No, no, I can't help this. No, no, we don't pull our way. It's driving me crazy. We can't help this. No, no, we don't have to worry.
That was rad.
Thanks.
Heck yeah.
Thank you.
So what's that tune about?
It's like, I guess it's about just not letting things go sour and like knowing when things need to end.
So how do you know when things need to end?
Usually you don't.
That's exactly
it. Yeah. That's where the songs come in.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So did that song come from a place where you'd gone too far?
Yep.
Yep.
Nice. It happens.
These things happen.
It's weird how you can play a song and then someone asks you questions about the song. Maybe this is a thing, right? Yeah. I think as like artists, we're like, we can't talk about the art.
And why do you think you can't talk about the art?
I don't know. I think it's like you're giving a piece of yourself in the songs.
And it's already been given in the song, and you don't want to double down and give the under the song, because there's already so much being exposed there, right?
Yeah, and I feel like it's important for, you know, like people to take their own interpretation or their own feeling to it. And like I feel like when you start taking your feeling to this, I might take away from your feeling to that. And I feel like that's important too, like important not to do.
And that's especially true with like the exposure we get to so many artists' personal lives through social media, and it's really hard to separate the art from the artist.
Yeah.
Do you find that when you're sharing on social media?
What, to separate from the art from the artist? I don't know. I guess.
What about you, Noel?
I don't segregate myself very well, like the parts of me. I'm like, here I am, don't know how to show you something different.
And then do you find your songs take on new meanings to people? Because now they get the song and they get the personality.
I try not to think too much about what other people think. It's hurt me in the past.
True. What about you, Jared?
I like that mentality.
Right on. Yeah. Okay, and I guess, yeah, we're wrapping up. Give it up for Jared and Noel. Thank you guys for having us.
Right on.
Great job, guys.
Thank you. The host with the most. I think Richard should stay up here. He did a fantastic job. Thank you. All right, we're going to welcome our next host up. Pablo, if you want to come up. All right, round of applause. Make him feel welcome, folks. All right, have a seat. Stay a while here. We'll chit chat for a sec while they. You on? Okay, one second. We're good. We're on. We're live? Yeah? No?
Yes.
Hi,
how are you? Yes.
All right. Thank you. Well, tell us a little bit about yourself, Pablo.
Excuse me?
Tell us a little bit about what you do.
Okay. So my name is Pablo Tovar. I organize multicultural festivals in London, Ontario, and other surrounding areas in Ontario. What I do is to promote diversity, equality, and inclusivity with my festivals. I start doing festival working on the food way, and then I start adding more of entertainment, music, and of course drinks, cocktails. So yeah,
all the key elements,
all the music, food, and drinks.
Yeah, that's great. And so tell us a little bit about like the music that you're into. We were talking a little bit earlier, you know, sort of about that sound and what you grew up with.
It's funny, and I'm from Colombia. I grew up in Colombia, and I wasn't the typical kid listening to salsa or Latin music. I started listening to punk rock, Spanish rock, and all reggae music. But I also appreciate all kind of music, you know, like from Motown music to like salsa music, so house music. So I appreciate the music, and that's the one thing that I love London. You know, it's my city. I love it, and I love the diversity of the talents that we have here. For sure, it's unbelievable. Like it's how like the talent that we have here is just like wow. In such a small city, it's just like cool.
Yeah. And your playlist, the songs that you've selected, the talent, it's so vast, and it really reflects what you just said.
Yes. I was at the beginning when I started like listening to all this. I found a huge playlist on Spotify. I'm gonna be honest with you, like because I know friends. You know, I go to breweries. I support local artists and everything. But I wanted to like look more like into it. I was gonna look more into it, and then I went to Spotify and I found like a playlist for like 100 bands from London, Ontario, and other surrounding areas. So I was just like, wow. So honestly, I took my time. You know, I was just like listening. And the idea of the playlist, it was just about diversity, okay? So you're gonna find my playlist, First Nation groups, you know, Latin American groups, you know, everyone's there, you know, from like pop music, from rock music, for folk music, all kind of music, so yeah.
Awesome. Yes. You have to check it out. You definitely have to check it out just to see 100%. How diverse it is and all the different sounds are there. So we have one artist today from your playlist. Tell us a little bit.
Yes.
Would you like to come onto the stage, Anna?
Sana. Hey, how are you?
Good.
Oh, this is amazing.
No, just that center line. You're not singing. Yeah. Should be okay.
So Sana, music, yes.
And I will turn it over to you at that point. So it's your stage.
Okay, cool. Hi, Sana, how are you?
I'm
really good. So, I'm from Colombia, and of course, I need to promote also my culture. I also need to promote my culture too, you know? So I'm glad and I'm so happy that she's going to be here. She's from Colombia too, and she's going to be performing 2 songs. Yeah?
Yep. I'm sorry. I'm actually from El Salvador.
Oh, okay, perfect. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
She's Latin American.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm excited to be here. Thank you so much for taking me into consideration. Yeah.
Yeah. And what's the name of the first song?
The first song I'll be performing is called Adore. So it's actually not original. It's a remake of a Kashmir Cat song. I made it into a bachata because I love that genre. So even though it's in English, it's kind of like the best of both worlds, you know, like singing in English, but also showcasing my Latin roots. Yeah, we'll be singing an acoustic version of that song.
Perfect. First. So yeah, go crazy.
Yeah, thank you.
We get to take our time. So what's been on your mind, yeah? It's just you all the time, yeah.
That's amazing.
Thank you.
Beautiful talent, yeah, for sure. Okay, so why that song? Tell me about it. Like, why you want to perform that song?
I think this song for me has been a game changer. I mean, I don't want to use that word because obviously I'm not like famous or anything, but it's definitely opened a lot of doors. It's opened a lot of doors for me in the bachata community. So this song I made in a bachata version. So in the dance community, and the bachata dance community, it's been very like welcomed, and you know, people post videos of them dancing to this song, and it's just been so heartwarming to see. Yeah, so I decided to sing that one.
That's amazing. That's amazing. Yeah. You're gonna perform another song, eh? Mm-hmm. And that's original from you?
Yes.
Okay, tell me about the song, please. I just wanna.
So this song I wrote about like 2 months ago. So I'm currently at OA Art. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of it. Yes. Yeah. So with my crewmates, we recorded this song, and I haven't released it yet, but I thought it would be nice to show you guys and give you guys a little taste of Xana. So yeah, hope you guys enjoy it.
Perfect. Thank you. Yeah. Go crazy.
Cause no one gets me like you do. Don't know this love the way we do. I never felt this feeling. And though I love the way you want me, you give me shivers when you hold me. Can't get enough of you. And though it's something about the way that you sound when you're tired, yeah, you light up a fire inside me. And I'm stuck on the things you do, falling in love with you. My heart comes out my chest when you kiss me and you tell me you miss me, yeah. Oh, and I'm right there with you. You're still here and I already miss you. And oh, it's something about the way that you sound when you're tired. Yeah, you light up a fire inside me. And I'm stuck on the things you do, falling in love with you. Ven mírame, ven y dime lo que sientes. Dime que me quieres, yeah. Llévame contigo, cause where you go, I'll go. Esto que sentimos, algo que tú ni que yo hemos sentido. Ya eres parte de mí, quédate aquí. Porque desde que tú llegaste a mi corazón no soy la misma sin ti. Oh, something about the way that you sound when you're tired. Yeah, yeah, you light up a fire inside me. And I'm stuck on the things you do.
Perfect. So what was the inspiration about the song? Like, where's it come from?
I think the inspiration just came from like being in love in a relationship. You know, I think we've all had that feeling where we have like certain things about that certain someone that we really like that aren't very like normal, I guess you could say. Like the song talks about, I like the way your voice sounds when you're tired. And I just feel like certain things like that just make for a romantic song. And I'm like, what's the word? hopeless romantic, I guess I would say I am. Yeah. Yeah.
One more last question. I just want to find out why you mix the English and Spanish. Like, this is so beautiful that you kept the roots of the Spanish language there. So, yeah. Tell me about that.
I think I just, you know, I'm so attached to my being Latina that I love incorporating the Spanish into my music. I love, you know, I feel like it's a musical representation of who I am. Like, I was born in Canada, but I'm Latina. So, you know, it's always going to be both, the best of both worlds. Yeah.
This is amazing.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much. She's amazing. So, yeah. So.
Fantastic. That was great. Wasn't that amazing? Yeah. Awesome. All right. We're going to do a quick changeover, and we are going to keep the music going. We're going to welcome our next curator, Zara Habib. Let's hear it for Zara. Amazing. Have a seat. Grab a guitar pick. Yeah. We left them out for everybody. All right, so Zara, we're going to talk about a couple things here. Maybe we'll start talking about a really cool project you just worked on, which is the ISO project. So can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yes. So hello, everybody. I want to thank you, Corey, for having me here, and thank all of the beautiful artists for being here and sharing your wonderful light with us. It's needed now more than ever. The ISO project is it's an interesting project. It's one that kind of was born in my mind. And it's been really, really gratifying with the support of the Music Office and the Film Festival and my wonderful team who's working with me on it to be undertaking all this work and all of this community building to make it come to life. So what it is it's a music video incubator project for artists of color based here in London, Ontario. And it isn't only for musicians, it's also for creatives of all stripes. Because we're doing this in partnership with the 4-City Film Festival, there is, and it was, the impetus kind of came from the 4-City Film Festival introducing a music video category as a part of their festival programming. We are incorporating all elements of music video production as part of the incubator. A lucky musician who's also an amazing musician who I'm sitting beside right now, is going to get a chance to have a music video created for a finished song that she has already recorded and mastered. And we're going to be taking her through the entire music video production process. So the point of this project is to give artists in London, as well as creatives in London, professional real-world experience in the industry of filmmaking and music video production. And also, that is something very relevant for musicians, just because, you know, since music videos were introduced, they've become an extremely important part of distributing your music, getting it out there, and making an impact. You know, it's an art form in its own right. And it's something that we really want to develop here in London. And with the wealth of talent that we have in the city, it's just such a great opportunity to do that. But more so than anything, give back to the creatives in London who are artists of color, who sometimes spaces aren't always so easy to get into. It's not always easy to be seen or have your work seen or heard or validated by, you know, by the institutions, by the power holders, et cetera, et cetera. One of the things that is so nice about London is that, you know, it's quite an open city as far as that's concerned. You know, the ground is quite fertile for an initiative like this to take place. And yes, it's an incubator for musicians, but I mean, we're all kind of learning together. We're all co-creating. We're all doing this process together, and this is the pilot year of the project. And we are so gratified and so excited to see where this is going to go.
And what's so exciting about that, it's an amazing project. It really is. And it's really about mentorship, too, in development and talent development and skill development. And what's so amazing about that is working on ISO and working on this playlist, enter Eleanor, right? And the first thought was, the first thing that you said, Zara, when you wanted to have an artist, like, oh my gosh, I have, like, we need to get Eleanor, and I wish that she was on my playlist kind of thing.
Oh yeah.
When it was created. So we have Eleanor here today. So welcome, Eleanor. And we need to get her a mic. Oh, Chuck's nice. Bringing one up here. So, she has a mic. We're good. Never mind. Oh, okay. There we go. Perfect. All right. Well, welcome, Eleanor.
Ooh, hey. Hi.
Hey.
I'm nervous.
Don't be. We got a friendly crowd here.
maybe we can breathe together. Ready? Okay, whatever happens, happens. It's been a while. Yeah.
Eleanor's going to perform? Okay.
Sure. Yeah.
Eleanor, tell us about the first song that you're going to be performing.
Oh, it's very flirty and sweet, and I was happy that something innocent came out of me and not, like, gnarled with sadness.
Is this Waste My Time?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Why do you say that? What was your expectation of yourself?
I like a sad song. I think okay. We were hearing something about that earlier.
Yes. Yeah. So you guys are going to do a collaboration after this, right?
Hey.
Okay, but let me ask you a question, because this was something that came to mind as people have been talking. Why do you like sad songs? And why do you like to create sad songs?
I don't think it's like a preference. I think it's more felt. So there's something, it's even easier for me to write in a minor key. I really liked what you had to say, though, about juxtaposition. And I was thinking about Hey Ya and like how sad that song is. But it's like a, you know, yeah, anyways. Just feels more natural. I don't know why. I want to change, to be honest.
You're perfect just the way that you are.
You're very kind. It's making me nervous.
Yeah. So, do you feel ready to perform Waste My Time?
Let's just do it.
Let's go.
Yeah. Just wondering where you were.
Give it up for Eleanor. Nervous what? While I'm getting your water, we've talked a little bit about this song. By the way, this song that you just heard is, you're going to see a music video for it in October, premiering at the Forest City Film Festival. That's the song that ISO is going to make for her. Thank you, Corey. When we were having the consultation sessions with you before we had decided who the winner of the project was going to be, we talked a lot about this song and this song in context of what the project is that you're going to be releasing it on. And you said a lot of really profound things about your approach, your process, your writing process, and what this EP, this bigger project that this song is going to be a part of, what that means. Would you like to share a little bit about that, about how, what this project is about? Okay. Anything related to, you know, the EP or the album that you're going to be putting this song out. This song is not a standalone song. It's part of a bigger project.
Right. It's a part of a, it's this, the flirty little note in a body of not flirty music, I think. And my project is called A Late Bloom, because I feel like a lot of my sadness comes from like a struggle with time and pace and life not happening when I want it to happen. Cue me breaking my leg. Like, yeah, so that's what it's called, because I realize every, like, it's something I didn't realize that it kept coming up in my writing. Like, even that flirty song was called Waste My Time. So everything, I don't know. It's something I hope to be working through by the end of this. I hope to be forward.
How does music help you work through what's going on in your life, what you're thinking, what you're feeling?
I think it helps you. Personally, it's like my connection to music is involuntary. And it's like, it's something like laughter. Laughter is not voluntary. It's just you're compelled to laugh. It's like that. When you listen to music, some things just give you goosebumps and they strike you. And I think it's helpful in life to see beauty in pain. I think it's something, it has something to do with how we process and move forward. So, yeah.
100%. For those of you who don't know, I'm also a DJ. So my work is very much involved in sound and in frequency and in energy as much as it is with curating curating music to convey that. And one thing I've noticed is that a lot of musicians, a lot of artists, you know, even who are not musicians, have a certain way of viewing the world. And it's depending on how dedicated they are to owning themselves as an artist, because that, there's, it's one thing to create music, and it's another thing to really embody where your music is coming from. And owning yourself, your identity as an artist in the process of making music. So when I hear a song like that, and just when I hear you sing, Eleanor, you know, you might call it sad, but I think you're, maybe you know this, I think you're channeling much more than just one emotion or two emotion or even emotions that we can speak for. You know, it's a whole experience that you're putting words to, that you are creating sound and melodies to. But it just is what makes the art such a delicate expression of oneself. And I think, you know, for you, you have found a way to truly express that from a genuine place.
That's so nice. Thanks, Sarah.
Honestly.
Thank you.
Honestly. So before we get to your next song, I know you've got another song to perform, but on that idea of owning yourself as an artist, what has that process been like for you? Has that been involuntary?
No, it's so daunting. I live in a really good community of musicians, and some of them are performers, and you know performers. Some of you have children who you knew they were performers at age one, and they were, like, my brother is a musician, and he's a lot bolder in the way that he carries his identity on stage, and it's like, for me, it's a muscle that I think I'll always have to exercise. I've gotten better about protecting my writing space, and that is like me, but performance is a harder part for me, I think, if that makes sense.
It makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, and there's a lot of, like, even just being seen is a strange thing. Like, even everyone in this room is looking at me. That's so weird if you think about it. Yeah.
Because you have a lot of recording experience, or more recording experience than you do performing as a front woman.
I like to play shows with a whole band and other singers.
Okay, okay.
I like the energy exchange.
Yeah.
I'm just, yeah.
It's quite daunting to have to carry all of that responsibility by yourself.
It's just a lot. And I don't know what to say. I don't know why. I can I present pretty well. I can, like, read a script. Oh. Yeah, but the performing is hard because you have to, like, live in the moment in front of people. There's like a weird symbiotic relationship, I think, happening in performance. But it's cool. It's really cool and powerful, and it's a privilege. Art is a privilege, so yeah. Oh my God. Best crowd ever, for sure.
So do you want to get into your second song?
Sure.
Want to tell us a little bit about what this is about?
It's called Former Friend. It's about like friendship loss. And yeah, you can sing along on the chorus. The chorus is "I feel stupid." Feel free to join in.
Stupid. eyes. With regret, I didn't know what I had until you left. You had me feeling, and now I'm scared to look stupid again. I feel stupid.
Incredible.
Thanks.
Incredible.
Thank you. I've never performed that one.
That's absolutely fantastic. It's great. One more time. Round of applause. Wow.
Can I say something? Yeah. Yeah, thank you so much, Eleanor. And, you know, we're so, so happy to be working with you on ISO and to make your dreams as an artist come true, truly.
Thank you. Thanks for the help.
Of course. I do want to take this moment to just make a quick statement, because while I have this platform here, and I feel like the crowd here would be very receptive to this message, I feel that over the course of the last 3 years, you know, we have changed a lot as a collective. We've changed a lot individually, every single one of us. And I hope that that is the case. When it comes to music and the arts, I can't really stress this enough, that music has been the thing that has saved a lot of people in this pandemic. Whether you make music or you just listen to it, everyone is nodding their heads. Wow, so y'all agree. And yet, at the same time, musicians tend to be some of the most hardworking and expected to be hardworking people, and not really seen as, you know, people who can earn a decent living off of the work that they do. And I think it's time that we really change that narrative, as we all... Seriously, truly, because the work that musicians do and the work that artists do is what lifts us up as a collective. You know, it. Hearing Eleanor sing, hearing all these beautiful musicians sing and play their instruments, that's putting out a frequency into the world. And if we can raise the frequency, you know, musicians are the first one who can change that, that quote that Noel had said. You know, how about I add on to it with, it's not about looking back to what disturbs us or what causes us to grieve only. You know, music is what can really help us step out of that, so that any moment, you know, even the challenges that we will inevitably face in life, we can do so with more strength, with more love, with more internal understanding, and with more compassion for one another. So please, yeah. I hope y'all take that to heart. Thank you.
Well said, very well said. So we've reached the final curator, the final performance. So Sarah, if you want to come to the stage. All right, let's hear it for Sarah. Jen, if you want to come and get set up as well.
But you.
Yeah. Well, thank you for being here. Hey, you stand, sit. What are you
thanks
thinking?
Thanks for having me. I don't know. I think I can sit.
I got a podium to hide behind.
Yeah,
so.
I'm like, oh, I've been sitting too long. But Bajo Kenawia, Wasazoan Unquain Indigenakaz, Nagik Nindodam, Michisakik Anishambe Kwe Indao, Shaganash Nene Nawusum, Alderville, Dushkin Zibing Ndonjaba. So I just told you all that I'm Otter Clan. I'm a member of Alderville First Nation, which is just outside of Peterborough, sort of. But I said Dushkin Zibing in Donjba because I was born in London, Ontario, and Dushkin Zibing is the name of the river that's just right out of here. And I told you my name in Ojibwe, but Sarah May, an Indigenous cause as well. And also, what else? Oh, I said, my dad's a white guy, so, you know, gotta say that part too. Third generation British settler. So I'm really happy to be here. I'm stunned by the, like, talent. And I think Richard said at the beginning, we have an amazing talent here in London. And I hate it when people are like, there's nothing to do in London. Like, if you follow me on Instagram, you cannot say there is nothing to do in London, because there's always something to do. And amazing communities that you probably haven't discovered yet, different cultural communities, different music communities, and it's really important, like Zara said, to get out of your comfort zone and go check stuff out. So thank you for being here.
Yeah. Again, well said. There's been some great dialogue and great discussion tonight, right? And I want to thank you for being here. Tell us a little bit about your playlist that you have, because we're here because of these playlists, right? That's what sort of shaped all this. So tell us a little bit about what someone could expect to hear on your Al Roke's Lead Downtown playlist.
Well, I was really excited when you invited me to participate in this, because I'm really passionate about the local music scene. Like, I really love, it's my community. And like Richard said, call the office. Like, I grew up there. That is how I know these people. That's how I know Zara. And now I just met Pablo. Like, you know, that's how I know a lot of people in this room, actually. Like, that's my friends, my family, kind of. So, my playlist, though, I really wanted to focus on Indigenous artists, but I wanted to challenge what we think about in terms of Indigenous art and music, because, you know, immediately people might think of traditional, like hand drumming, like for sure, that is part of it. But also, you know, I have like Snacks on there, which a lot of people might be like, what? There's no Indigenous people or racialized people in that band, but Dustin is Indigenous and he doesn't talk about it because everyone's like, you don't look Indigenous, and you know, those kinds of things. And I won't speak for him, but that was one thing. And same with Hellephant. So I wanted to like I'm a punk rocker, like I like, you know, punk rock music. And it's just so rad when you find someone else that's Indigenous that's in the music scene and into the music you're into. So Hellephant is on there, and Chris is actually from Alderville First Nation. So that was how someone was like, you guys have to meet because you're actually from the same community and you live in London and you both like punk music. So like, you know, like those kinds of things. And then also just like, I think Corey, you had said five sort of male and five female, and I kind of tipped the balance a little bit because I went with, you know, the ladies, and I would have went with genderqueer, but Willow Switch isn't on Spotify, and and so I tipped it with like Anella in the Early Hours, and then Jen Marino in the Hearts, and I can tell you a bit more about why I picked Jen Marino in the Hearts too in a second. But who else is on there? Mall Crimes, because they are radical to the bone. You got to check them out. They're probably not everyone in this room's cup of tea, but if you don't check them out, you're missing out. They're just amazing. And I'm trying to think who else is on there. Never Betters, who were kind of like a retired sort of London band, but I had to because Davida is a member of London Girls Rock Camp, or like she helped kind of get it off the ground with Savannah Sewell, and has been a part of it. And that's another thing, I would have put Thunder Queens, who are a girl London Girls Rock Camp, but they don't have Spotify, so that was like, you know, and so
holding us back. Spotify.
Yeah, so it's just kind of like all of these things, like all of these people, these stories, these that are doing amazing things, and it's so important, especially too, to support the youth. So if you haven't checked out Thunder Queens, you gotta, and like make opportunities like London Girls Rock Camp for people to get into music and make those opportunities. So yeah. So that's like a bit about who I would have put on my list, who is on my list. I could probably make a huge, long playlist of all the awesomeness.
And so today, though, we have
today
Jen and Tyler from Jen and the Hearts.
Yes, Jen and the Hearts. So Jen Marino, full disclosure, maybe this is like biased, but she's a really good friend of mine. And the first time I heard her sing, I got goosebumps, and I still get goosebumps. And I had goosebumps all night from Susanna and from Eleanor, like just goosebumps. Jared, you did not give me goosebumps, but I still loved it. I know. But Jen is also, and I maybe like, this was going to be kind of one of my questions, so maybe I'll just kind of preface it with saying that Jen is also a huge supporter of the London music scene, and she's also a really strong advocate for chronic illness and just women in music, and just like always wants to lift other people up and is really supportive. And so I was like, well, like, let's get her on the stage and everyone else can get goosebumps and everyone else can get excited. So maybe if you guys play a song and then I'll ask you some questions. Is that
sounds good? I'm gonna step off the stage and we'll hear a song. So Jen and the Hearts.
Jen and the Hearts. This is part of Jen and two of Jen and
two of the four. Thank you, Sarah May. Thank you, Corey. This song's called Wreckage.
You're the victim, I'm a casualty. Feel the blood now rushing back to me. Crash landing, such a tragedy. You don't wanna leave me. I couldn't see through the night, see through the night. We fell out. Whoa.
That was amazing. So, me glad you're performing that. So, I mean, I guess I could ask you about, like, you know, your song and your writing process and those kinds of things. But first, I want to talk about supporting other musicians and supporting the music scene. I just was wondering if you wanted to talk about some of the things that you're passionate about and that you advocate for.
For sure, because over the pandemic, it was definitely... I was just sitting at home going, what are we really using our platform for? What are we really using Instagram for? Why are artists just using it to promote themselves? And why not support our community? So I asked the guys, and the guys let me do whatever I want. So I just was like, yeah, if like the pairs made an announcement that they're playing a festival, well, I'm going to share it. Or like Heart Attack Kids made a new music video, or Pro Wrestling just did a new music video. Well, we're going to share it. Like, we're here as a community, and I've been in this community singing since age 9. I took a couple years break, and it was really funny because when I first started singing, and I was singing in the bars, and I had a band, and I was very young and underage, and very supportive parents that helped me through it. And I took a little bit of a break, and when I came back, I met Sarah May. And I came back, and I met Tyler and Mike, and I needed a break. I was tired, and I was done with the music scene for a bit. And when I came back, there was all these new people who were so refreshed and so ready to take on this scene. And it changed. Like, London changed. When I joined the Hearts, it was just like, I joined a community who wanted to do things. People wanted to book like the shows. People wanted to attend. Not just the musicians, but like Sarah May. Like, I cannot explain to you how important she is to all of us. Like, for real. No, like, and everyone can attest to it. Like, if it was not for her, then people wouldn't know what shows are happening. People wouldn't know. And then I was like, well, I'm a curator, just like Sarah May's a curator. We need curators. We need people who are going to spread the word of these musicians, new or old. And so, yeah, I've used my platform, like, sharing shows, sharing new music videos, sharing new projects. Like, everyone should be sharing. And I've noticed Heart Attack Kids are starting to do it too. And I appreciate it because as a woman who started in a music scene that had no women, I was the only one my age doing what I was doing. And now that I'm in a scene where there's, like, tonight, oh my gosh, seeing every single woman up on stage, and like, it has blown my mind how much London has changed for the best, because try to get a bunch of guys that were in the same shows all the time to come to a show, to come to a woman's show, it's still hard. It's really hard, and I'm not going to lie to you. It's not happening still in some scenes. But with Sarah May and with, like, the women I've seen here tonight, and that's another thing that we've just been focusing on. Like, we changed our name, and members of our team who associated more with that name had left, and when they did, and we got our new drummer Mark, and Mike and Tyler, and all the guys were talking about what will we change the name to? Mike and Tyler, I brought it up years ago, and I didn't want to do it then, but now seemed like the right time to use my name for the good, like a superhero, to use it for the good, because women need to be represented, women need to be seen, and every show we do, I don't even have to question, like, these guys bring it up before even I do, who are the women in the show, who are the women working the show. We play the hall because women can be behind the stage, they can be doing security, doing the bar, they can do the lighting, they do the stage hands. Our last few shows we booked in London have been women-centric, and that's really, really important for us, and seeing it tonight has, like, made me so excited, because it needs to happen. There needs to be more women in music being seen, because we're here, and it's thanks to them. It's thanks to the curators tonight and to Sarah May, and it's for real. Like, it wouldn't be the same without you.
It's not the same without everyone that has been here.
Yeah.
Even, like, I just, like, think about, like, the work that Zara's done and Harina with, like, Plump Sessions.
Yeah.
And talking about platforms, too. And, like, you know, how I got into this music scene, too, is writing about music. And I wrote for London Fuse, RIP, an independent media platform that really filled a lot of gaps in this city, especially with mainstream media. Like, just, they gave me a sandbox, and I got to play, and I got to cover stuff that was important to me, and it was important to other people because they read it and they shared it and they cared about it. But You know, I'll pitch a story to some mainstream organizations and they don't take freelancers. So, you know, how do you get marginalized, made marginalized voices in your organization if you're not even gonna hire freelancers? So, yeah, so I guess I should let you guys play a song because okay. Everyone's like, it's yeah. getting late.
It's getting late.
People gotta go home. But yeah, so.
It's changed so much. We're like used to going on at 10 and now we're
yeah.
like,
yeah,
now we wanna go home
for a lot
10.
Of people here, yeah.
So much like, has happened in 2 years.
There's
oh my
probably
gosh.
Shows about to start.
yeah. Yeah, if you have tickets to the beaches, talk about supporting women. I'll finish this and like get it over with. But this song's called Reach Out.
When you feel it, something's up behind you. Already there, turn around, appears out of thin air. I'm your reality, know you're there, trying to find me, so your mind and your heart, 'cause you've been mine right from the start. See ya creeping around every bedpost, you're creeping in the broad daylight. Then you feel a shot cutting up your heartstrings. Reach out, nobody's there. Turn around, you're down a thin your heart, 'cause you've been mine right from the start. One little shot, that's all you will say, then you're mine for the taking, the very next
Thank you.
Thanks, buddy. Is this one mine? I don't think I should have you.
Another incredible performance. Wow.
Thank you, Corey.
Wow, so many of these like stripped down performances. I didn't know how it would all work out, but I think it worked out pretty darn well. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, round of applause for all the musicians. Round of applause for all our curators here tonight. It's been incredible. And our gracious host, Museum London. Thank you. Words Fest, Josh and your team. You guys are fantastic as always. And I hope everyone's been able to enjoy the open house that's been happening here. Lots of great things going on. I see Lisa's got the draw, and we are ready to go. So we got a draw here. We got two. Do you want to talk about it for a sec? Yeah.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming tonight. So what we're drawing for is two tickets to Magister's concert coming back up Thursday, May 26th. It'll be taking place in the Lecture Theater. And so we're about to do the draw here.
All right. You want me to draw it and read it? Okay. Oh, this is pressure. Can I read it first and foremost? Mohammed? Oh, perfect. Okay. Mohammed. Doing a second one? I'll take that. Well, congratulations. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks again for all the amazing hosts, all the amazing curators. Please check out the playlist, All Routes Lead Downtown. It's on the London Music Office Spotify channel. Please dig into some of these artists and enjoy them. I'm going to get off the stage now and let you enjoy your night. Thank you.